Thank you, Mike, for almost like 20 years, two decades of friendship with the family. And thank you for inviting me back. I remember when I first I spoke at the very first summit back in Singapore back in 2006. Since then, spoke again in 2008 or 9 in Mission Host Dongguan, and I've not been back. And I apologize for not being back. Mainly because, as many of you are, know, that my father was diagnosed with cancer back in 2007. And when he first discovered it, it was at the fourth stage already. So I had to take on the shoulder of responsibility of leading a company at a very young age. And that's why, hence, I've not been too active in the APGS summit for the past years. And I apologize for that, and I want to thank Mike for bringing all of us together annually, and for all of us to share ideas, exchange business concepts, and to promote the game for Asia growth collectively. So I suggest that we all put our hands together to thank Mike Sebastian for all his initiatives. Thank you. Well, we all have different interpretations of golf. To me, golf has three meanings, three different stages of experiences, and I'll share with you my experiences of golf and golf development in China. To many, I'm sure, golf in the modern language stands for green, oxygen, light, and friendship. I also have a lot of Christian golf friends that believe that golf stands for God offers love and forgiveness, or God, God our loving Father. I just want to raise a question. I don't know why. It seems like all the golf functions that we attend is a tradition that 90% or above are men, okay? Similarly today. My question is, how many wives out there, or how many gentlemen's wives are golf widows? Mine is. Can I have a show of hand? That wives don't play golf. Okay, it's better in the scene. It's only 10%. So yeah, we all have heard of gentlemen's only, ladies forbidden, and then I've also learned from a German article that I've read in the past that to please the golf widows, they introduced a car named after golf, so it's the Golf GTI from Volkswagen. And so that the ladies, the golf widow, can have some part of golf. So the Golf GTI actually stands for, did you know that? It's, girls only love fun. And GTI stands for, so get them in. So I that is the problem with golf, the way that I see it. It's, it's a healthy game. I mean, men, the gentlemen's, it's much better to spend 4.5 hours on the golf course, walking 8 kilometers, chatting, and breathing fresh air, instead of, you know, going to bowling nights or poker games. Or in China, we do karaoke, mahjong, sauna, etc. You know, so that is the problem with golf development that I see for China. As many of you may know, that Asians have a lot of family core values. And so how do we keep the ladies happy while we play golf? So I think that that's the problem with global golf. It's that a lot of ladies, a lot of wives are not taken care of, and you don't spend enough time with the kids, or you're not being a good son by spending a lot of time with your parents. And that is what I am doing right now. My three stages of golf, I tell you, First stage was when I was educated in Canada, in Toronto. I thought golf was a retirement game, an old man's game. Watching golf on TV, literally, it's like watching paint dry on the wall. It's the same amount of time to tune in golf while the paint dries on the wall. That was my early days of understanding, interpretation of golf. It's not until I came back to Hong Kong and China, then I realized that golf is actually a business language, social networking tool. It's an extension of the office. It's where business deals are a strike. So I knew immediately that if I don't speak the language, I don't play the game, I'm not in the circle. Just like not knowing the stock prices, the NASDAQ S&P trading prices. And then, that's why golf has snowballed tremendously in China. I remember when we started golf 2 decades ago, back in 92, China's golf population was only like 50,000. And 20 years later, we're at 5 million today. 5 million golfers is not a lot compared to, you know, Korea, Japan, Europe, and US. And same thing, golf courses, it's very minimal. Official figure is 500. A lot of people say there's 600, but actually there's about 900. So courses in China. And obviously you all know of the golf moratorium in China. So the problem with golf development right now is this is where I see the future of golf for China, how I want to develop golf for the Chinese market. It's to make golf for 4 generations and to make golf for all ages. What that means is it's golf and more. And meaning that you got to introduce much more than golf to incentivize the ladies, the kids, and the elderly. You got to spend time with your loved ones as much as you can while they're alive. Because my father died at the age of 61. So I have actually learned and absorbed a lot over the past 7 years of his sickness and death. So this is what I want to tie golf with the core values of the Asian mentality, which is family, harmony. We believe that if you have a happy family, then work, business will go well. And then that's when prosperity comes. So everything starts with a happy family, a harmonious environment. And so that's what I'm doing right now, is adding golf to much more. And so I'm proud, very proud to say that today, we actually operate 2 mega resorts and then a few other new destinations in the making. The 2 mega resorts, one is in Guangdong province, and that's a 12-course facility, pure membership club. And we don't accept outside play. And that's why a lot of golf clubs in China struggle, is they run the membership system while accepting golf tourism. That completely conflicts with our members' rights. Now, in Hainan Island, we develop our next resort in Haikou City. That's the capital of Hainan Island. Over there, I'm proud to say that we have developed, not the largest, but the largest public golf resort in the world. Meaning that golf is no longer a rich man's sport, an expensive game. You don't have to pay, $500,000 to $1 million for golf membership to have the right to play golf in China. So the 10 courses that we have there, it's all open for play at different price range. If as cheap as like $25 to as expensive as $200 for a round of golf. Actually, it's more. It's $300 US round. So we're catered to different needs and different markets of the golfers. And we actually developed this 10-course facility in a very short span of time, only 1.5 years. Well, I had to rush this project for simply two reasons. Number one, it was as I said earlier, my father was diagnosed with cancer in 2007, and then right before he was diagnosed, he signed a contract with the Hainan government to build this mega facility. And then he wanted me to do something for him. He wanted me to do two things. First thing was to fulfill his dreams, his vision. And number two is to deliver his promise to the Chinese government. So, I mean, we haven't even invested a buck except for just the air freights. And I promised him to do it purely because I wanted to give him some motivation, something to look forward. So that's why we built this development, 10 courses in 1.5 years, just so that he can see the finished product. And also to expand his vision, grow his vision, which is to popularize the game of golf. And so I was very glad that I call upon my old friend, Brian Curley, whom have worked with the initial Mission Hills project in Guangdong province. We have 12 courses there, 10 of the 12 courses. We worked together and then invited a lot of signature designers to help with the branding of the course. And in Hainan, together with Brian and his master planning to residential community development planning to construction management, we managed to drive a crew of 60 shapers, and we completed the course development in 1.5 years. And that was also during the period of the Lehman Brothers, so the entire economic turmoil. So that's why I want to make this project a very meaningful project to help to grow the game. Hence, that's why we made it public. Otherwise, if we were to sell membership, the ROI would be much quicker. We could have done it in like the ROI in 2 to 3 years. But now, I think that's not enough. Pure golf, to a lot of Chinese family or even to international travelers, that's too little. I want to add much more facility to cater the family as a whole, as I said earlier. So what I'm doing right now, I think we're the only golf club in the world to have a ice skating ring. It's a 1,800 Olympic size skating ring. To have Olympic size indoor pools, to have IMAX theaters, to have bowling alleys. And for those who have been to Abu Dhabi, the Ferrari World, they have 6 race car simulators. We're gonna have 26 race car simulators. And then that's like arcade. So, and yeah, 26 simulators are driving on all the racetracks of the world, F1 racetracks, and then together we're gonna drive through the 24 courses of Mission Hills. We're driving the race car on the golf courses. So that is, it's a gimmick. And then also, including that, we're adding in 250 new shop operators, brands from nightclubs, cafes, restaurants, to karaoke's, massage parlors, etc. I mean, it's not inside a golf club, not inside a golf course, because at the end we should keep golf, the gentleman's game. We should respect the etiquette of the golf. But it's only like a 3-minute drive adjacent to the golf property. That's where the nightlife is. So I am turning golf into a 24-hour operation. A day club crossovering a nightclub. For those who have been to Lan Kwai Fong in Hong Kong, I'm working with the father of Lan Kwai Fong, Alan Zeman. We're bringing in the Lan Kwai Fong of Hong Kong into Hainan. So with 250 brands, shops, outlets, F&B, Michelin stars, restaurants, that's what we're doing, to make golf for all ages. Not necessarily they'll come as a first time to play golf, but at least they're incentivized to go with daddy, to spend a holiday, to spend a weekend, a vacation together collectively, because there's something for everybody to do. Because a lot of golf club, if you don't play golf, you don't go to a golf club. You don't even dine in a golf club. So that is what I'm doing to change the future of China golf development. Because at the end of the day, I want to share with you all a much bigger picture. I don't have the world golf traveling numbers, but I know the Chinese tourism numbers. You may want to write this down because it may give you some ideas on how to tap into this huge, huge market. China today exports outbound travelers. It was ranked number two last year, number three last year, after Germany, U.S., and then China. But 2003, China will even surpass the Germany on the international travelers. This year, to 2013, there will be 90 million Chinese traveling worldwide, with a total spending of 118 billion U.S. dollar. And 85%, it's within Asia. 85% is being spent, of 118 billion U.S. dollars is spent within Asia. Now, this year, China, for instance, it will be the third most visited country internationally. So now we're talking inbound. Number one inbound traveler is France. Second followed by USA, third is China. With 50 million inbound travelers coming into China. And the total expenditure consumption is 58 billion US dollar. So this is the pool I'm working with. I want to grow the business, not just the golf. I want to capture not just the golf tourism, but the tourism in general as a whole. How do we tie in golf with family activities, with cultural visits, to tap into the 50 million travelers that's coming into China this year? Now, this number is not even scary enough. The most scary number is domestic Chinese traveler within the country. We all know the population for China golf, China domestic population is 1.3 billion. But Chinese traveling within China, the number is 3.25 billion. That's averaging one person travel at least once. 1.3 billion population to travelers to 3.25 billion, with total expenditure of 216 billion US dollars of consumptions. Now, if I was to add those numbers together, the golf population, the golf population internationally, it's only, what is it? It's like 20-something thousand, no. U.S. has 30 million. Internationally, you're talking about maybe less than 50 million. So that is, no, much less than that. Does anybody know? 56 million. So 56 million, all of, you're talking about the entire tourism number. That is less than even 1%. So in order for golf, the way that I see it, in order for golf to grow in China, we must cater to the massive tourism market. That is completely where the ROI is. If there is one thing that I want all of you to take back today, my key message is I'm a big advocate of the three P. First P is the people, second P is planet, and the third P is profit. Obviously, people have no idea why I do public golf, because public golf ROI is too slow. But then, obviously, profit. Any corporation, any business got to be profitable. Otherwise, you're a liability to your colleagues, liability to the government, liability to the society. So, I mean, grow the tourism market, make the pie much bigger. That is what I'm doing today with Mission Hills. With all these commercial development, shopping malls that we're introducing into the facility, we're talking about a 22 million square feet of fun and joy. 22 million square feet, including working with all the brands, hotel brands of the world. We're adding right now on the plan, there's 6 hotels, 5-star hotel, and then plus 18 boutique hotels, working with all the international brands. So, you know, golf course usually is quite remote. So collectively, you know, watching a movie with one actor is boring. Bring many more people, actor and actresses, into the pool, into the stage, to make it more fun, to allow all brands to help you market. That's why I'm bringing in 250 retailers into Hainan, 250 retailers into Shenzhen, just so that we can promote the destination collectively together. So, I mean, make money elsewhere. Make money, I mean, we even give free Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is even accessible in the bathroom. I mean, why charge a can of Coke in a mini bar for $4 US dollar? Whereas we just sell it for a buck US. I mean, you gotta win word of mouth. Don't make money on small money, right? I mean, there are things that you can escalate on prices, such as Wagyu beef, lobsters, and unis, etc., on the wine. And then obviously, at the end of the day, it is residential development, and of which, Brian, thank you for doing so much planning for us, so that all the homeowners always have a protective view of greenery. Because the most expensive greener, most expensive colors, it's either green or blue. Blue is the ocean, green is greenery, gardens, parks, and golf courses. And so a company's got to be profitable. And the second P is people. People, you got to look after the colleagues so that they grow together with you. And then not only the colleagues, but also the community as a whole. Meaning that this means to responsible tourism. Responsible tourism, it's when a developer goes to a new place, they don't earn all the money. They don't absorb all the money from that community. But together, grow with the community as a whole so that everybody wins. Unlike cruise line buy all the docks. So once the people get off the boat on cruise lines, they shop and dine and experience at cruise ownerships, properties. So grow with the community collectively. It's responsible tourism. You buy the crops, you buy their meat, and then you encourage the tourists when they come to visit you to also spend money to learn the local culture, the local food. So that's what responsible tourism is about. That's how you take care of people. And then the third P is planet. You know, everyone's so concerned about CO2 and PM2.5. And I'm so glad that what we have done is converting wasteland into green space, into green economy. That's what we're doing today. And I'm so proud that we are actually the largest carbon offsetter for the city. And we actually planted, like every year we plant over 200,000 trees, new trees. And I usually plant expensive trees because they will appreciate. Instead of buying red wine and store it, I plant trees. It's an investment. So protecting the Earth, you win applauses, and that's what the world wants. It's cleaner air, and we even recirculate all the gray water from the hotel, from the convention center that we have, from the malls and shops. We circulate the gray water, not for drinking, but to irrigate, not the golf course, but all the shrubs, all the mountains surrounding the facility. I mean, the amount of water we consume, we can supply 500,000 households annually. And then electricity, as you all know, China is a powerhouse in industrial. So electricity is more expensive during the day versus night. So I use the electricity, I don't fight with the manufacturers. I use the electricity at night to make ice. And we melt the ice to use it for air conditioning during the day. And then same thing, the laundry room, we use the hot water, the heat from the laundry room to boil the water for the locker rooms, the hot water for the locker rooms and the hotels. So that's what sustainability development is about. That's what responsible tourism is all about. And that is what the 3P is all about. And that is what I am doing today. Because we all get picked on, and that's something that I've learned from the States, is in the early days, environmental issue used to be a big issue for golf development. So I've learned that. So I want to lead by example, by showcasing a new white paper, blueprint for developing golf courses for China. How do you make golf green economy as a sustainable development model for China? That is the only way that you can unlift the moratorium of golf development for China. So, I mean, the game is still scoring so rapidly. There's no stopping. By year 2020, they speculate that Chinese golf population will surpass USA. So, as a golf business, it's great, but I want to make golf accessible for four generations, for all ages, so that everyone can be looked after. And that is how I want to transform what I said, the third stage of golf development for China. And in closing, I want to share with you the mission statement of Mission Hills. Mission statement is usually the reason for a corporation's existence. Why do you exist in this world? My father, when he initiated Mission Hills, his vision was to promote international goodwill through golf. And after two decades, I wanted to add something else onto this mission statement. Not only do I have to live the legacy, and also to fulfill his legacy, and also to continue the bridging of the East meets West through international goodwill through golf, but also I want to promote three H's. The first H is happy, second H is healthy, third H is harmony. That is the new Mission Hills mission statement, is to inspire a healthy, happy, and harmonious lifestyle to all. And that is where I see the family value is, the future of golf development. So wish you all a happy, healthy, and harmonious lifestyle. Thank you for having me on stage today.